श्री साई सच्चरित्र चैप्टर 43 एंड 44। बाबाज पासिंग अवे कंटिन्यूड। प्रिपरेशन समाधि मंदिर, ब्रेकिंग ऑफ द ब्रिक, 72 आवर्स समाधि, जोक्स संन्यास, बाबाज नेक्टर लाइक वर्ड्स। चैप्टर 43 एंड 44 कंटिन्यू द स्टोरी ऑफ बाबाज पासिंग अवे एंड देयर फोर दे आर टेकन टुगेदर। प्रीवियस प्रिपरेशन। इट इज़ द जनरल practice amongst the Hindus that when a man is about to die, some good religious scripture is read out to him, with the object that his mind should be withdrawn from worldly things and fixed in matters spiritual, so that his future progress should be natural and easy. Everybody knows that when King Parikshit was cursed by the son of a Brahmin Rishi and was about to die, after a week, the great sage Shuka expounded to him the famous Bhagavat Purana in that week. This practice is followed even now, and the Gita, Bhagavat and other sacred books are read out to dying persons. Baba, being an incarnation of God, needed no such help. But just to set an example to the people, he followed this practice. When he knew that he was to pass away soon, he ordered one Mr. Vazi to read Rama Vijaya to him. Mr. Vazi read the book once in the week. Then Baba asked him to read the same again day and night, and he finished the second reading in 3 days. Thus 11 days passed. Then again he read for 3 days and he was exhausted. So Baba let him go and kept himself quiet. He abided in his self and was waiting for the last moment. 2 or 3 days earlier, Baba had stopped his morning peregrination, going out and begging rounds, and sat in the masjid. He was conscious to the last and was advising the devotees not to lose heart. He let everybody know the exact time of his departure. Kaka Sahib Dikshit and Shriman Bhuti were dining daily with him in the masjid. That day, 15th October, after the aarti, he asked them to go to their residence for dining. Still a few, like Lakshmi Bai Shinde, Bhagoji Shinde, Bayaji, Lakshman Bala Shimpi and Nana Saheb Nimorkar remained there. Shyama was sitting down on the steps. After giving rupees 9 to Lakshmi Bai Shinde, Baba said that he did not feel well there in the masjid and that he should be taken to the stone wada of Bhuti, where he would be all right. While saying these last words, he leaned on Bayaji's body and breathed his last. Bhagoji noticed that his breathing had stopped, and he immediately told this to Nana Saheb Nimorkar, who was sitting below. Nana Saheb brought some water and poured it in Baba's mouth. It came out. Then he cried out loudly, "O Deva!" Baba seemed just to open his eyes and say, "Ah," in a low tone. But it soon became evident that Baba had left his body for good. The news of Baba's passing away spread like a wildfire in the village of Shirdi, and all people, men, women and children, ran to the masjid and began to mourn this loss in various ways. Some cried out loudly, some wallowed on in the streets, and some fell down senseless. Tears ran down from the eyes of all, and everyone was smitten with sorrow. Then the question arose, how to dispose of Baba's body? Some Mohammedans said that the body should be interred in an open space and a tomb built over it. Even Kushal Chand and Amir Shakkar shared this opinion. But Ramachandra Patil, the village officer, said to the villagers, with a firm and determined voice, "Your thought is not acceptable to us. Baba's body should be nowhere placed except in the wada." Thus, people were divided on this point, and discussion regarding this point went on for 36 hours. On Wednesday morning, Baba appeared to Lakshman Mahajoshi in his dream and, drawing him by his hand, said, "Get up soon. Bapu Sahib thinks that I am dead and so he won't come. You do the worship and the Kakad Aarti." Lakshman Mama was the village astrologer and was the maternal uncle of Shyama. He was an orthodox Brahmin and daily first worshipped Baba in the morning and then all the village deities. He had full faith in Baba. After the vision, he came with all the puja materials and, not minding the protests of the Maulvis, did the puja and the Kakad Aarti with all due formalities and went away. Then at noon, Bapu Sahib Jog came with all others and went through the noon Aarti ceremony as usual. After paying due respect to Baba's words, the people decided to place his body in the wada and started digging the central portion there. In the evening of Tuesday, the sub-inspector came from Rahata and others from other places turned up, and they all agreed to the proposal. Next morning, Amir Bhai came from Bombay and the Mamlatdar from Kopargaon. The people seemed divided in their opinion. Some insisted on interring his body in the open field. The Mamlatdar therefore took a general vote and found that the proposal of to use the Wada secured double the number of votes. He, however, wanted to refer the matter to the collector, and Kaka Sahib Dikshit got himself ready to go to Ahmednagar. In the meanwhile, by Baba's inspiration, there was a change in the opinion of the other people, and all the people unanimously voted for the proposal. On Wednesday evening, Baba's body was taken in procession and brought to the Wada and was interred there with due formalities in the Garbha, that is the central portion reserved for Muralidhar. In fact, Baba became the Muralidhar and the Wada became a temple and a holy shrine where so many devotees since then have been going to find rest and peace. All the obsequies of Baba were duly performed by Bapu Saheb Bhate and Upasani, a great devotee of Baba. It may be noted here that, as observed by Professor Narke, Baba's body did not get stiff though it was exposed for 36 hours, and that all the limbs were elastic, and that his kafani could be taken out without being torn to pieces. Breaking of the brick. Some days before Baba's departure, there occurred an ominous sign foreboding the event. There was in the masjid an old brick on which Baba rested his hand and sat. At night times, he leaned against it and had his asan. This went on for many years. One day during Baba's absence, a boy who was sweeping the floor took it up in his hands, and unfortunately it slipped from thence, fell down and was broken into two pieces. When Baba came to know about this, he bemoaned its loss, crying, "It's not the brick, but my fate that has been broken into pieces. It was my lifelong companion. With it, I always meditated on the self. It was as dear to me as my life. It has left me today." Some may raise here a question. Why should Baba express this sorrow for such an inanimate thing as a brick? To this, Hematfant replies that saints incarnate in this world with the express mission of saving the poor, helpless people, and when they embody themselves and mix and act with the people, they act like them, that is, outwardly they laugh, play and cry like all other people, but inwardly they are wide awake to their duties and mission. 72 hours samadhi. 32 years before this, that is 1886 AD, Baba made an attempt to cross the borderline. On a Margashira Purnima full moon day, Baba suffered from a severe attack of asthma. To get rid of it, Baba decided to take his prana high up and go into samadhi. He said to Bhagat Mahal Sapati, "Protect my body for 3 days. If I return, it will be all right. If I do not bury my body in that open land," pointing to it, "and fix 2 flags there as a mark." After saying this, Baba fell down at about 10 p.m. His breathing stopped as well as his pulse. It seemed as if his prana left the body. All the people, including the villagers, came there and wanted to hold an inquest and bury the body in the place pointed by Baba. But Mahalsapati prevented this. With Baba's body on his lap, he sat full 3 days guarding it. After 3 days passed, Baba showed signs of life at 3 a.m. His breathing commenced. The abdomen began to move. His eyes opened, and stretching his limbs, Baba returned to consciousness, life again. From this and other accounts, let the readers consider whether Sai Baba was the 3.5 cubit body that he occupied for some years and that he left thereafter, or he was the self inside. The body composed of the 5 elements is perishable and transient, but the self within is the thing, absolute reality, which is immortal and intransient. This pure being, consciousness or Brahma, the ruler and controller of the senses and mind, is the thing Sai. This pervades all things in the universe, and there is no space without it. For fulfilling his mission, he assumed the body, and after he was fulfilled, he threw away the body, the finite aspect, and assumed his infinite aspect. Sai ever lives, as also the previous incarnation of God Dattatreya, Sri Narasimha Saraswati of Gangapur. His passing away is only an outward aspect, but really he pervades all animate and inanimate things and is their inner controller and ruler. This can be and is even now experienced by many who surrender themselves completely to Him and worship Him with wholehearted devotion. Though it is not possible for us to see Baba's form now onwards, still if we go to Shirdi, we shall find His beautiful lifelike portrait adorning the masjid. This has been drawn by Shamrao Jaikar, a famous artist and well-known devotee of Baba. To an imaginative and devout spectator, this portrait was given even today, can give even today the satisfaction of taking Baba's darshan. Though Baba has no body now, He lives there and everywhere and will affect the welfare of the devotees even now as He was doing before when He was embodied. Saints like Baba never die. Though they look like men, they are in reality God Himself. Bapu Saheb Jog's Sannyas. Hemad Pant closes this chapter with the account of Jog's Sannyasa. Sakharam Hari alias Bapu Saheb Jog was the uncle of the famous Varkari Vishnu Bua Jog of Pune. He had no issue. After his retirement from government service in 1909 AD, he came and lived in Shirdi with his wife. Both husband and wife loved Baba and spent all their time in worshipping and serving Baba. After Megha's death, Bapu Saheb Jog did the Aarti ceremony in the Masjid and Chavadi till Baba's Mahasamadhi. He was also entrusted with the work of reading and explaining Jnaneshwari and Eknath Bhagavat in Shatheswada to the audience. After serving for many years, Jog asked Baba, "I have served you so long, my mind is not yet calm and composed. How is it that my contact with saints has not improved me? When will you bless me?" Hearing the Bhakta's prayer, Baba replied, "In due time, your bad actions, their fruit or result will be destroyed. Your merits and demerits will be reduced to ashes, and I shall consider you blessed when you will renounce all attachments, conquer lust and sense of taste, and getting rid of all impediments, serve God wholeheartedly and resort to the begging bowl, accept sannyasa." After some time, Baba's words came true. His wife predeceased him, and as he had no other attachment, he became free and accepted sannyasa before his death and realized the goal of his life. Baba's nectar-like words. The kind and merciful Sai Baba said many a time the following sweet words in the masjid. "He who loves me most always sees me. The whole world is desolate to him without me. He who tells no stories but mine, he ceaselessly meditates upon me and always chants my name. I feel indebted to him who surrenders himself completely to me and ever remembers me. I shall repay his debt by giving him salvation, self-realization. I am dependent on him who thinks and hungers after me and who does not eat anything without first offering it to me. He who thus comes to me becomes one with me, just as a river gets to the sea and becomes merged one with it. So, leaving out pride and egoism and with no trace of them, you should surrender yourself to me who is seated in your heart." Who is this me? Sai Baba expounded many a time who this me or I is. He said, "You need not go far or anywhere in search of me. Barring your name and form, there exists in you as well as in all beings a sense of being of consciousness of being or consciousness of existence. That is myself. Knowing this, you see me inside yourself as well as in all beings. If you practice this, you will realize all pervasiveness and thus attain oneness with me." Hemad Pant therefore makes a bow to the readers and requests them humbly and lovingly that they should love and respect all gods, saints and devotees. Has not Baba often said, "He who carps and cavils at others pierces me in the heart and injures me, but he that suffers and endures pleases me most." Baba thus pervades all beings and creatures and besets them on all sides. He likes nothing but love to all beings. Such nectar, pure, auspicious ambrosia always flowed from Baba's lips. He therefore concludes, "Those who lovingly sing Baba's fame and those who hear the same with love both become one with Baba." Bow to Shri Sai. Peace be to all.